aware that it forgive me, it's become emotional. That lady is in Zimbabwe right now. So if yes, why elsewhere? Well, I think they are adding on to the number. But the one that I'm talking to is in Zimbabwe. So to hide the identity, she has a real name. I'll call her Sarah. To hide her identity, I'll call her Sarah. But her real name was mentioned somewhere on Jean's blog. If you go through the blog where it's mentioned, their name is mentioned there. There's a name which is mentioned, and that's her name. In a recent post, the blogger from the church from Agape wrote that most accounts given about his past were all blatant lies meant to galvanize the whole church against the man of God. The writer was referring to what has passed in Zionja, his past marriage, his days at the University of Zimbabwe and Kokomele High School. I'm quoting because it was written on the blog. As far as I know, these accounts were accurate, Pastor Findi. If you testify today that these were accurate, they were accurate. I also contributed, but what I wrote was accurate as well. And I will talk about a bit of his life at the University of Zimbabwe and his marriage to Sarah, my friend. And to start with, this was no man of God. I refuse to call him a man of God, to call him a pastor or a bishop. Those who went to the Christian Union at the University of Zimbabwe with him confirmed that yes, he was an orator, very persuasive. When he prayed, you make people fall, but he was not a serious Christian. I know a bit about his past marriage, so I will add to the proof that he lied about his past. This man, I won't say his name, he started accounting owners at the University of Zimbabwe from 1984 to 1986. My friend Sarah, who later became his wife, and me joined the same university in 1986. And my friend was worse as a junior, studying the same degree she was studying accounting. So then they met at the university's Christian Union, and I have actual names of some of the chairpersons, the press secretaries, the CU students union representative during the time. And I've been in touch with them, I found them. Who actually confirmed this information, you know, what was happening at the University of Zimbabwe. His current wife, the one that he has, is not his first wife. His first wife was Sarah, and I remember, I'm not using the correct name. Mm-hmm. And for me, if you need to form a church, form it on the basis of the truth. It's about the truth is if you are in church. So if you start it on lies, you are building a house of cards which you will eventually fall, and this is what is happening, isn't it? So Sarah and I met at a college during A level. We studied the same subject. We sat next to each other in classes. We loved and cried together, and we were in the same study group, working hard to better our futures. And she told me about a difficult childhood. Her story resonated with mine, and part of her story, the story of an ordinary African woman, inspired me to write my book, this book called Being a Woman in Africa. Stories of abuse, psychological, physical, economic, emotional, of church leaders who rape and abuse underage girls, of polygamy, of how girls struggle and work extremely hard to get an education in Africa, and after that, after they get an education, like what happened to my friend Sarah. Unscrupulous men like this pastor, they take advantage of their innocence, they manipulate them and then dump them. This is what happened to my friend. And I've lived this with this for years and years and years, and I'm really sad about that. So after all this sweating and toiling, Sarah went and graduated, and then we met at a workplace, at the same workplace. This pastor was working for the water department. Sarah told me about the intimate details of her relationship to this man, and I won't go into this detail, but this man was cheating on her, lying to her, abusing her psychologically and financially, not coming home for weeks, pretending he was out of the country on business, yet he was with other women. I could quote actual incidents with the actual locations where my friend caught him in the act. And my friend really suffered under this man. And later on, he tried to manipulate her into accepting his desire for women, arguing that, you know, it's an African man's thing. And then this is not true. I'm sure this sounds familiar, ladies and gentlemen. And if someone today is feeling trapped, if you are in such a trap, what I'm saying is we need to speak out. And Pastor Cindy, from what you said, from what my friend told me, this Agape vision did not start today. It's a business plan which this man had planned for years. He planned it carefully over a long period of time when he was doing audit work for the Zimbabwe government. I believe this is where this terminology about attaches and envoys came from. He's a prophet of prophets who carefully studies.
Prophet of prophet.
Who carefully studied how to write a vision? Isn't there a vision in Agape? You know, that's what business people do, right? Visions for their businesses. Mm-hmm. They have a clear strategy and action plan. And he started this target very well, and we really feel sorry for the followers. And then he delves into what they do for a living, and then he takes advantage of them, started their lifestyles, and then created a niche for the church. Yeah, and I remember I said oratory skills, and this is how he targeted the ordinary people. And probably his skills are the ones which swept my friend away, you know, in 1986. So all I want to say to Walter today is to the men, sorry I mentioned the name, it's a small world. You cannot hide from the truth. Today it's about the truth. It's about exposing the truth. Let's talk about it, Pastor Cindy, Pastor Evangelist Jean, and all the other speakers. Let's talk about it. It's about the world needs to hear us. Let's do it together. We have heard what we need to do. We have seen what we need to do, and now is the time to do it, and together we can do it. So, as I finish off, I want to dedicate this book to all women who have been raped and abused, and that includes my friend Sarah. Thank you. To my friend Sarah, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ruth. I'm not sure whether you completely got where Ruth was standing. It's called standing in the gap. That was not Ruth's story per se, but she was a part of that story. She was a part of that journey. She was very entwined with the woman that had that story. That woman is not here to speak out or to share with us. So Ruth took it upon herself, and she did that unthinkable. You know, she did that thing that I call stepping out of those boxes and to speak out on behalf of someone. So if you know someone yourself that is going through stuff, let's just use the word stuff, and you feel that they are not maybe strong enough, you know, or they're not confident enough to speak out, please take that responsibility to speak on their behalf. Thank you so much, Ruth. Wishing you all the best with the book.